This morning, we heard some fantastic conversation around topics ranging from human-machine collaboration to human-machine fusion. In the afternoon, we're going to take a step deeper into those topics. In this panel, we're going to take a step deeper into human-machine collaboration, specifically on critical tasks, critical applications in defense and civilian life. Here at APL, we think about human-machine collaboration as a trade space. We're on one extreme, machines act as tools. Think about the anti-lock brake system in your car, where that's an automated function, but it's fairly low level with respect to the overall task of driving. As we move towards the other extreme, machines are becoming more like partners, where they can take on increasingly sophisticated tasks autonomously as part of a human-machine team. Back to the driving illustration, now on the extreme, think about the driverless car, where I get in the back, press the button, and it takes me to my destination. Where we fall in this trade space for any given application is dynamic and depends on the nature of the application. Specifically, where we fall lies at the intersection of what machines are capable of doing, what we will trust them to do, and the specific mechanisms by which we team. All right, now on the point of trust, these are my kids, Noah and Maya, and they're in the back of our Prius right there. And this is just a few weeks ago, they're about to be driven to school by, not by an algorithm, but by their mom. And as I think about the extreme, machines as partners, as excited as I am about that eventuality as a researcher, as a parent, I'm not quite there yet. I'm not ready to put my kids in the back of a driverless car to get them to school or to get them to the doctor. And what makes me nervous about that is a concept of generalization. And what I mean by that is the generalization of learned knowledge to new and novel situations. The ability to generalize using intuition is a hallmark of human intelligence. If I want to drive a car, I'll take a class. I'll go to driver's ed. And then every time I get behind the wheel, I encounter a slightly new situation. And we can deal with that as human beings. We are not quite there yet with machines. We don't know how to make machines today that use the same level of intuition to generalize knowledge to new situations. This is an algorithm that was looking at you when you came into the building, if you had a chance to stop by. All right, this is a computer vision algorithm, and it's providing semantic descriptions of object classes it wasn't specifically trained to recognize. A very interesting capability for a machine. Under the hood here is a convolutional neural network, and it's got 34 layers. And because of the convolutional nature of the network, those 34 layers give rise to over 30 million tunable parameters. All right, so this is an astounding capability, but we don't have the theory today to be able to characterize the way in which this will generalize in arbitrary situations, which means we don't know how to characterize those corner cases that come up. Again, thinking about driving, think about the catastrophic crash that the Tesla car experienced last year, where its computer vision algorithm, under the lighting conditions of the day, couldn't tell the back of a white truck from the sky. And of course, we all know that resulted in a fatality. That is the challenge that lies ahead as we think about moving technologies like this into more and more autonomous roles in critical applications. But what we're really excited about is realizing that future. So if we can rise to that challenge, we can realize some of what our sponsors are asking for, which is, in defense applications, autonomous teammates, like you see in this air combat example, that can take on the riskier roles in combat and reduce risk to manned platforms. Or in the center, you can have an intelligence analyst with a smart algorithm helping to sort through very complex data, like we heard Secretary Work talking about earlier today. Or in the hospital, you can think about having robots to assist with surgery, or again, algorithms helping with the task of triaging and screening patients. So as we move forward, these are the kinds of applications we're working for. And as we move into this panel, we're going to talk more about where we fall in this trade space and how we continue to push to the right. And with that, I'd like to introduce my panel. Matt Johnson is a researcher with the Florida Institute of Human-Machine Cognition, and he's a former naval aviator. Through the many research projects he's led for DOD and NASA, he's taken on the perspective that no robot is an island. Today, he's going to share that perspective and his thoughts on coactive design for human-machine collaboration. Jason Matheny is the director of the Intelligence Advanced Research Projects Activity, leading its portfolio of high-risk, high-payoff projects supporting national intelligence. IARPA has a focus on computer human-machine collaboration, but not for embodied systems, but for the kind of analytic challenges that we talked about. Today, we're going to get some insight into Jason's portfolio and the bets that he's taken to fill the gaps there. And then finally, Suchi Saria is an assistant professor of computer science at Johns Hopkins University. She leads a research lab that does work at the intersection of AI, machine learning, and medicine. In 2015, she was named an IEEE Intelligent Systems, one of the 10 to watch in AI. And in 2016, she was named one of Popular Science's Brilliant 10. All right, I'm very excited to hear this panel's thoughts today. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Johnson.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation today. This has been a great conversation in the morning. I really enjoyed it. I do think we omitted Blade Runner, and I'm sorry about that. That's one of my favorites. But today I'm going to talk a little bit about how do we step up to these challenges and actually make them happen? And I think one of the things we've talked about a lot is team human-machine collaboration, human-machine teaming, and human-machine interaction. But if I look at all the advances in technology and what machines are capable of doing, one of the places I don't think we're making a lot of advances is in that teaming, in that interaction. I think we're still sort of rudimentally stuck at an early stage of development as far as interaction goes. And I think one way we're going to have to step up to improve that is really change the questions we're asking when we design these systems. And the way we do that is, today's topic is machines and us, and really focusing on the and part. What does it mean to be an and, a machine and a person? Jeff kind of touched on it this morning about, it's really about what you can do with the machine. How do you leverage the machine so that the two of you can do what neither of you could do individually? When you think about this question, it's really about, when you think about this question, it's really not about asking just what the machine can do, but what it can do with you. And as a background, I'm going to talk a little bit about the DARPA robotics challenge. This challenge came up in the wake of Fukushima and other disasters. We had a lot of advanced robotic capabilities at the time, but none of them brought anything to bear to solve the problem or to help in any way. And so DARPA came up with a challenge to say, hey, robotics community, how can you step up and address some of these things? And I'll show you the challenge they came up with here. This is a little clip from the DARPA Robotics Challenge. There were 8 tasks designed to simulate a disaster response. And so the first thing you had to do was get your robot to the destination. So you had to drive a vehicle through an obstacle course, pull up to a building and park. Then you had to get out of a vehicle, which seems easy until you've got a 400-pound robot inside of a little Polaris Ranger, and then it's a really challenging thing to do. You'll notice how low the vehicle is at this point, and when he steps off, it comes up about 6 inches. That kind of gives you an idea of how massive this robot is. Not exactly your user-friendly model. Here he goes, stepping down, and then he'll get up. And then after this, you've got to enter the building and do a variety of tasks. And as you go in the building, DARPA hits you with some more reality of bad network connection. So you have about 20 to 30 second latency inside the building. And while you're in there, you have to do a variety of tasks, like turn a valve. You have to grab a drill and cut a pattern out on the wall. And then they had a surprise task. In this case, it was to move a plug from one socket to another. We didn't know about that task until the night before, so you kind of had to adapt your system on the fly there. And then once you're done with all of that, they make leaving the building difficult by throwing some rubble in front of you that you have to either walk over or through. And then finally, once you get past the rubble, you exit the building and there's some industrial stairs you have to climb up. And then that'll wrap up your day. That's 8 different tasks you had to do. And so here we go, finishing the DARPA challenge. What you don't see in the video off to the left is there's a bunch of stands and fans. And so our what we do here is a little showboating at the end and give a little wave to the crowd, which is always a crowd favorite. Hello there, crowd. You might be asking, why are we talking about machines and us and you're showing me a robot doing a bunch of really cool tasks? That's nice. That doesn't make any sense. Well, the little secret besides the fact that the robot was doing this is behind that robot is an operator. Our team had an operator, and every other team in the DARPA Robotics Challenge had people driving these robots around, usually more than one. There's our operator right there. His name is John. There's always going to be people involved with these systems. More importantly, we could not finish that task autonomously. In fact, no teams finished any of the 8 subtasks autonomously. So there's a huge gap there in technology that requires human input. That's one issue. if you flip it to the other side, there's no human being that could do that without automated assistance. If you try to control 30 degrees of freedom through all that complexity, it's a very daunting challenge, and the only way you're going to make that happen is through automation. So the secret of the DARPA robotics challenge was the only way to complete it was by a combination of machine and person. That was the only way to do it. This is true of most big technological achievements. Dave Mendel's got a great book out there on the Apollo landing, and he kind of points the same issue with Apollo landing. The only way we got to the moon was both through technology advancement combined with people. If you remove either one of those, the people or the technology, you wouldn't get to the moon. So that raises the question of how do we design these systems? To me, it's not just a problem of designing a machine to do work, it's designing a machine to do work with a person. And I think that's the question that we haven't been addressing directly and we need to start thinking about. And it really involves a fundamental change. If you look at the approaches we use to design these systems, things like functional allocation and supervisory control take a task allocation approach, which is you can decompose a task and hand a piece of that task off to a machine. More recently, you've had approaches of adjustable autonomy, sliding autonomy, flexible autonomy. Any adjective that means change in front of the word autonomy captures the concept that this has to be dynamic. You have to adjust it over time because the real world is a complex place and it's always changing. And then there was mixed initiative interaction, which starts to get towards interaction itself. It talks about each agent contributing what it does best. But unfortunately, in practice, it tends to look like adjustable autonomy. All these approaches underneath have the basic idea that task decomposition and functional allocation is how we do this work. And so the questions they ask are really what to automate and to what extent. Unfortunately, for teamwork and for general work in general, as complex work in general, when it comes to the job itself, the problem is not decomposition; it's recomposing those pieces into the integrated whole, and that's the challenge of teamwork, and that's the challenge that we're not really addressing very well in the world of robotics and AI in general. So that really changes how you think about the goal of robotic systems. A lot of times we think about the goal is to make autonomous systems. We want autonomous cars, we want autonomous drones, whatever the case may be. We want to take a machine that is dependent on people and make it independent through autonomy. I would suggest that that's not the right goal. Jeff asked, what's my vision? My vision is not an independent system, it's an interdependent system. Interdependence is necessary but not sufficient. What I want is an interdependent system that works with me to do what I want to do. And the way we get there is through designing for teamwork. A little side effect, if you start from an autonomy perspective, what you end up doing is building a machine that then its behavior dictates the interaction. I propose that you need to flip this. You need to invert this relationship. If your vision is interdependence, that's what you should be designing for. And then your automation, your machine learning, or whatever it might be, should be designed around the interaction. One of the issues with machine learning is it's a black box. And so you have programs like DARPA XAI for helping to open up that black box. If we had started from the principle that this thing needs to be explainable from the beginning, we wouldn't have to go through this process. This interdependence concept is throughout all of robotics and artificial intelligence in general. It doesn't matter whether you're doing something like the DARPA Robotics Challenge, where you have a remote operator in a remote vehicle, or something like Alias Program, which has a robotic co-pilot sitting next to a human pilot. The location doesn't matter. It also doesn't matter whether you have a one-to-one relationship or a many-to-many relationship, which is the bottom left-hand corner there. You still have interdependence in that system. And it also doesn't matter whether you're doing loosely coupled behavior or something more tightly coupled, like exoskeletons, as you see in the bottom right-hand corner. The problem with all of these is how you design the interaction and really how you design for interdependence. And so to me, that means we need to change the question we're asking, not what should I automate and to what extent, but really how can we make machines better teammates, or more specifically, how do I design for interdependence? Anders' talk summed it up really nicely. He mentioned a few issues with technology, transparency, being able to understand the system. He mentioned having an intuition about what it's going to do, which is prediction into what that system's going to do. And then in order to trust it, you need to be able to influence that system in some meaningful way, which I would call directability. If you look at all three of those concepts, they're not about automation or doing work. They're about interdependence relationships between you and the machine, which is why I think interdependence is sort of a fundamental concept we need to start bringing into the conversation as we design these systems. So on that, I'm done.
Thank you very much. Jason, I know you're not going to use it. Keep it until Suchi needs it.
Yeah. Here, I'll hand it in advance. Yeah. So I'm so thrilled by this program. And thanks to Ashley and to Christine and to Ralph for organizing this. It's also great to see old friends and colleagues. I was fortunate enough to share an office with Anders 10 years ago. And I can say that Anders has been this smart and happy forever, as far as I know, without any form of human enhancement that involves illegal chemicals. It's just natural. We're doing the genotyping to figure that out. So one of the things that IRPA does is fund research on human judgment, and we also fund research on machine learning. We fund research on high-performance computing. We fund research on new sensors. What's getting harder to figure out is what are the separations among those. Jacob Fogelstein's program, Microns, it was a program at the intersection really of humans and computing to understand what's the computational basis for how the brain operates, and can we imitate that in ways that are useful for the next generation of computing and machine learning. But where we've been spending a lot of time recently is at that intersection between human judgment and machine learning. So that's what I'll talk about. When I first came to the intelligence community, Adam Russell and I sort of did a road trip through the different intelligence agencies asking intel analysts about the kinds of tools that they use, the kinds of tools that they wanted, the kinds of capabilities that they needed. And to Jeff Ling's point earlier, you have to be careful about what sort of question you ask. So if you ask the intelligence analysts, what kind of tool do you really need? They'll say something like, well, I need a version of Microsoft Word that portion marks appropriately and is able to import documents well. You don't want to ask that sort of question. You want to ask, what's your aspiration as an intelligence analyst? What problem are you trying to solve? And when we asked that question, we found analysts wanted to make more accurate forecasts about events. Because the primary responsibility of the intelligence community really is to provide strategic warning. What we don't know is about the relative accuracy of humans and machine models and some hybrids in making accurate forecasts. So when we asked analysts, well, if we started developing tools for you that would make forecasts about geopolitical events, whether it's foreign elections or multilateral treaties or weapons tests or whatever, would you use those tools? And by and large, the answer was no. Because unless the tool could provide complete explainability and transparency to an analyst, they would not be able to defend it to a decision maker, to a member of the National Security Council. If they're not going to be able to brief this and explain how a system reached a particular result, they would not use that tool. So the first project that we ran at IRPA to try to solve this problem was one where we sort of cheated. We applied machine learning not to a bunch of obscure data the analysts wouldn't understand, but we applied it instead to their own judgments. So we ran what ended up being the world's largest forecasting tournament, in which we recruited tens of thousands of participants, both within the IC as well as outside of the IC. They generated millions of forecasts for geopolitical events, including things like elections and treaties and weapons tests, all of which were scored for accuracy. And by the way, most of this data is now publicly available on Harvard's Dataverse, so you can start to tease and do some data mining of your own on these data. A few things came out of this that were really interesting. One was the fancy machine learning approaches applied to this data really didn't perform that much better than simply taking the raw average of judgments. That is, this sort of wisdom of the crowd, in this case a fairly select crowd, was very hard to beat. The ways that you could beat it was by looking at historical accuracy and looking at the characteristics of the forecasters, who were quite diverse. In addition to intel analysts, we had a couple Nobel laureates, we had hedge fund managers, world poker champions, but we also had undergrads and pharmacists and baristas. So all of those people contributed data, and what we found was that the people who are most accurate were not necessarily the best credentialed or the deepest domain experts, but were people who were deeply self-critical, epistemically humble, would revise their judgments when presented with new information, and tested very highly on tests of fluid intelligence. But the best forecaster overall was not a single forecaster, but instead was the average of forecasters. So again, going to this idea of sort of ensemble models, in this case of human judgments. We then decided there are certain classes of problems where you're not going to know enough in advance to ask the right questions of human analysts. So we need some kind of alerting or indications and warning system. Let's try to develop the machine learning approaches that would be useful for those. So we ran another program, also a large geopolitical forecasting tournament, In this case, also involving millions of forecasts that were scored for accuracy, but involving only machines. And they combed through 30,000 different data streams, including things like social media, web search queries, commodity prices, commercial overhead imagery, looking for indicators of things like disease outbreaks or political instability. So finding correlations of things like when people get sick, their mobile phones don't go to work and back. Or when people get sick, they cancel their dinner reservations and they cancel their flight plans. Those are the kinds of correlations that analysts could find useful, but only if they were explained in a way to the analysts that they could defend. So built from the start of this program was the requirement that all of the systems be explainable in natural language. And that ended up consuming about half of the effort of the researchers, and they were really irritated by this. Because it meant that they couldn't, in most cases, use the best, you know, deep neural net approaches to solve this problem. They had to use, you know, kernel-based methods that were easier to explain. But by baking that in from the beginning, maybe we got that, you know, 20 to 30% performance loss in accuracy or lead time, but these tools were actually adopted. They were used by analysts because they were explainable. So that was one key lesson, was just bake in explainability from the start. After that program, we decided, let's try to figure out how to draw on the best of both human judgments and machine models. And this is a remarkably sparse research area in judgmental tasks. So we have a few examples of things like centaur chess or freestyle chess. We have examples from experimental financial markets in which you've got algorithmic traders and human traders who are collaborating and competing. But we know actually very little about the relative performance of humans and machines on judgmental tasks and cases where they can collaborate or compete. So we started a new program called the Hybrid Forecasting Competition that's focused on that problem. It's just kicking off. And some of the approaches I think are really compelling and interesting, including things like using prediction markets in which you've got bots and humans interacting and correcting each other, but also cases where you've got humans that are decomposing problems, or where you've got certain classes of questions that are known to follow historical base rates that a model is going to more accurately predict than a human. So I have a couple of requests. So first is participate in this research program because we do need tens of thousands of research volunteers. And you know, this is sort of like a John Henry experiment where I want the humans to have a decent chance in beating the machines. So please, you know, visit our website or send me an email, and I would love to volunteer you for this. You get bragging rights. I mean, some people put their scores in these forecasting tournaments on their LinkedIn page. They used it in their applications to CIA agencies or to their next job at the hedge fund. But the other thing is that you do develop a sense of where we know things and where we should remain humble. And I think that's enormously important. My second request is if you're developing an autonomous system for analysis that's intended for intelligence analysts, please bake in explainability from the start, because otherwise the tool will not be used. It won't be trusted. A third is we need to take, I think, more seriously cases of adversarial machine learning, which are not ordinarily addressed in machine learning research, because of real instances of denial and deception that are being used now in this new age where we're developing a lot of automation to make sense of data. At IARPA, we have a program called ODIN that's looking at adversarial machine learning attacks against biometrics, so how do you spoof biometrics, and developing systems to shore up our defenses against those spoofs. My last request is that you think carefully about the kinds of technologies that we develop. I loved Andrew's point about differential technology progress. Develop those defenses that we need and often sort of produce after the fact in order to patch a system. Let's put those at the front end of an R&D effort, because even when we're developing a security structure around a program, as we know, about half the time that security structure fails. So we really need to think more consciously and deliberately, I think, at the beginnings of research programs, what would we regret if the system became accessible broadly before a defensive capability exists. Thanks.
Jason, thank you very much for those insightful comments. So Suchi, would you tell us a little bit more about your work?
Sure. Should I be waiting for my slides to come up?
Yes, they should be coming up shortly. There we are.
Wonderful. So it's been such a terrific day. It's been so exciting to hear a lot of the ideas starting all the way from the morning when with Reed, with hearing now Jason talk about adversarial nature and how machines will behave in this. So I'm a professor of machine learning. This is what I do. I'm a researcher. I want to go back and unpack a little bit in terms of technically. What are the places where our current techniques are very good, and where are the places where the gaps are? And then think about sort of a lot of the ideas that have been brought up today in terms of, you know, what the future is going to look like, where the technical gaps are, and how does that boat, you know, gives us a sense for, you know, how near or far away that future is. So Reed this morning spoke about AlphaGo, and you know, it's made a huge splash. Lots of people are talking about AlphaGo. So I want to unpack a little bit what AlphaGo is doing. So in AlphaGo, what happened is, essentially, this is a machine that's learning how to play the game of Go. And you know, while it had extremely good, you know, machine learning models that could learn at any given state, if I make this particular move, what the reward will be. One thing that was interesting about AlphaGo was the way it was learning. Okay, and the way it was learning was as follows. You essentially could put a whole bunch of, so in AlphaGo, one thing they had going for them is the fact that the game is really easy to specify. You sit in a particular state. If you were to make this move, you know what the next state is. And essentially, you can, as a result, simulate the game. So now you have hordes of machines in a room, imagine, literally sitting there playing AlphaGo. And they play against each other. And what do? They essentially are playing against each other, and they know if they make a move what the result is going to be. And they keep doing this over time, and then eventually they get a reward. And the reward is, did they win or lose? Now, once you get this reward, you can use algorithms, optimization algorithms specifically, like I mentioned this morning, backprop, that allows you to backtrack from that reward into every given state, an analysis for at any given state, was it a good idea or not to have done that? Right? So essentially you say in games where we repeatedly win, you're going to backtrack to understand in a given state, if I made this move, you know, I often win, therefore it's a good move. And in, you know, when I make a move where I often lose, it's a bad move. Okay? So that's basically the idea. Okay, so what are the two, you know, so there are three key ingredients. One, powerful models that could learn. Two, this notion of learning from simulation or interaction where it could basically play it out, interact with the environment, right? It could basically experiment and say, if I do this, what's going to happen? If I do that, what's going to happen? And it could experiment, get a reward, and then effectively backtrack. And the third thing is that the best AlphaGo player has to, it's still a game where you essentially don't have to worry about non-stationarity. In other words, it's not like the world around it is changing. It's still learning a stationary, it has a fixed objective. It has the stationary world assumption, okay? So learning from interaction, you have the ability to interact and simulate. You have the ability to interact and not just simulate, but really truly observe what would happen if you did something. Second, you have the ability to effectively backtrack and learn, and then really it's a fixed objective. So you don't have to worry about things like lifelong learning or learning to constantly generalize, okay? So that's AlphaGo. Now, I think there are places where this will be very, very useful as a paradigm, right? So this paradigm is really useful. You could imagine rooms of robots fighting with each other, and we could develop extremely smart weapons of mass destruction or robots that are very good at doing physical tasks. Because if it can physically manipulate and do something and observe how the world changes, then it can learn things, right? It can learn from interaction. But I want to shift a little bit of attention because this is one area. AI and machine learning are very broadly in many areas. And I'm going to pick one that Reed spoke about this morning, another that I work a lot in, which is AI and machine learning applications in medicine, for example, where you can't walk up to a human and give them a drug and watch what happened, or you can't go cut up a tissue and see if that was the right way to cut the tissue. The ability to experiment is limited, right? and the ability to, so, and moreover, we don't have great simulators. The ability to simulate an entire human is really hard. The ability to design drugs with the assumption that I have a really great simulator of the entire, of all the organ systems it might affect and how is hard, right? So effectively, what do we do in these applications? And in order to make things really concrete, this is actually going to resonate with Jason because it's along the lines of something, you know, adverse event detection. But so I'm going to give you a concrete example. You know, $88 billion annually are spent in what are called hospital-acquired complications. Effectively, sepsis is one of them. It's the 11th leading cause of death. It's preventable if treated early. And what we're trying to do is to teach machines how to spot these diseases, which is very much Jason's task of, like, you know, you have these high-dimensional streams that are moving around. And the question is, from this, can we spot when a person's going to have an adverse event? Sepsis is an example of an adverse event. If you could have detected it sooner, you can come in early, give the right drug, and this thing is treatable. But if you don't detect it in time, death rates are 1 in 2. And essentially, in this example, so in these examples, what do? We can't easily experiment. And I think much of machine learning and AI is in the world where we have to think about the case where we don't have the ability to we don't have the game of Go in our board, the board game of Go in our heads. And we can't, as a result, generate these traces to learn from. So in this particular example, for instance, you know, what I'm showing you on the screen is basically a table. And effectively, if you take classical machine learning techniques, which are like supervised learning techniques, even deep neural networks, for example, and you employ them on these kinds of data, you know, on this screen, what I'm showing you is if you put it in one environment, it could learn a really, really powerful learning algorithm that says, I can spot this disease very fast. You could put it in other settings. These are called classical supervised learning techniques. You put your favorite DNN, CNN, RNN, whichever version of a supervised learning algorithm you'd like. Now, here's the challenge. As we're starting machine learning algorithms going out in the wild, going in the real world, where they're interacting, they're being deployed, much like the kinds of things APL deals with in battlefield, we're having to think about the fact that how well does it generalize? Generalize to new environments that are a little bit different from the training data where you worked on. And so in this example, what I'm showing is, you know, I show 5 scenarios. This is using, you know, very clean data where I say, look, in the first 2 columns, I say, if I were in the first 2 rows, 1 and 2 are, you know, if I have train and test where the environments are exactly the same, supervised learning behaves really well. So if it, the assumption of IID, independent, identically distributed, between training and testing, or one environment where you learned it, the different environment where you deploy it. But as soon as you start taking the test environment and deviating from your train environment, your generalization suffers. And effectively, what I'm doing for you here is I'm changing, in this particular example, how doctors are practicing medicine, right? So they give different drugs, different treatments. At Hopkins, they behave one way. They behave really, really well. They're world-class doctors. At Harvard, not so much, kidding. But you effectively are getting people who practice a little bit differently, and what essentially you get is like something, these supervised learning algorithms that are learning these adverse event detectors at Harvard, like at Hopkins, will work really well here, but as soon as there's changes in the environment, changes in practice patterns, these don't generalize. So we can unpack a little bit more in detail why this happens, but effectively the question is, if we want to build machine learning systems that live in the real world, we will need machines by construction almost that can adapt, that can learn, do lifelong learning. And in fact, Hava was one of the commentators early this morning, and she has a new program she's starting on this. And so the interesting thing is, when you can learn from interaction, you can continue to learn in a lifelong way. What are ways when you don't have access to the full world? What do? So now let me give you some good news, because that sounded like bad news. So good news is, well, there's lots of natural experiments in the world, right? You can get data from Hopkins, you can get data from Harvard, you can get data from USC. As you see more people, as you see more data, people practice behavior, you know, there are natural variations that happen in the environment that get captured in these data sets. And so the question is, rather than just learning from interaction, you can effectively build machines that learn to generalize well by taking advantage incrementally as it observes new sources of natural variation in the world, right? So essentially, you don't want to forget. You want to know what you've already learned, but you also want to be able to adapt to new sources of variation as you observe them. And in order to be able to adapt well, you need models that have certain properties. Now, I have only 7 minutes, so I can't talk at length about these. But for example, you can build these models that have modularity and compositionality and causal structure. And these have better, essentially, if you could learn how treatments affect the individual, and you could learn how, in the absence of treatment, how they behave, now, effectively, rather than learning models that are very susceptible to provider practice patterns, you can get models that generalize better as you change the environments. These are called causal compositional models, for example. And in the bottom, what I'm showing you are these tables where we show now classical supervised learning techniques don't generalize, but these causal compositional models are very good and robust to natural sources of variation of certain kinds. And so I think there are new agenda items where, you know, learning from interaction is a paradigm, but we'll have to continue to be able to take advantage of natural sources of variation and learn models where we can ask this question of, you know, what would happen if I had done this? What would happen if I had done that? And learn models that can generalize, have this property where we are not scared to deploy them. The example he mentioned, that he wants to be able to put his kids in a car without worrying about the fact that the car is going to crash. And in order to do that, we need these sort of, you know, you need to not have experienced every kind of crash, because you're not going to be able to experience every kind of crash. You're going to have to learn to generalize. And how do you build models or models with certain types of properties that have better generalization properties, right? So that's point number one. Exploit natural sources of variation. As you see new incoming streams, recognize things you've seen that are new. Learn how to adapt to these things that are new. And techniques that are better at generalization, techniques that are better at learning and generalizing to new environments. Second is this idea I said, right? In order to be able to learn and adapt, you need to understand, and especially as we build systems, like for instance, in our lab, we are building systems that are getting deployed in hospitals. We really, and to be just sort of in case, you know, people here are getting worried, these are still, you know, these systems have guarantees. They're still better than state-of-the-art in any way, so they're not imposing any new harm. But in order to make them even better, what we need is for them to be sentient in the following way. They need to know when they don't know. They need to identify when is it that they're observing something that is new and different from what they've seen before. And be able to say to the something in doing collaborative decision making, you know, Jason is really good at something, and he'll say, hey, I'm not so good at that. Why don't you talk to this other human being? This is an important aspect of collaborative decision making. You build trust. You learn how to interact with each other. Why? Because we know our limitations. I am good at X, and I'm really not good at Y. And when we interact with each other, we communicate this. We communicate levels of trust. And right now, our performance is the kind of performance which we benchmark in offline data sets. But in online settings, we kind of just assume IID, train test, are very similar. Even if they are deviations, we don't really know if there are individual cases where we're in a setting where we don't have a good clue of what we don't know. So I think building a framework of knowing what you don't know is really important in order to aid lifelong learning. And then third, which I think is sort of the most natural sort of tie-in with AlphaGo, is the ability to do bounded, safe exploration, right? So essentially, you have lots of natural experiments, you're learning from these natural experiments, you're continuously identifying things things you don't know. If a natural experiment is presented to you, well, I don't know this, I will see it run out and see what happens. Based on that, I'll update my model. But at times, when you have the ability, you want to also be able to experiment and experiment within safe bounds. When you have the ability to say, well, I could try A or B, it's not so harmful, there are no real disastrous consequences. And by being able to experiment, I can still collect some limited data in some settings. And how do you integrate these ideas? And I think from a machine learning standpoint, these are sort of really exciting directions where the field is going, where I think, which will increase sort of the capacity of applications beyond, robots fighting in a room. So thank you.
Suchi, thank you very much.